First of all, I'd like to start off with a remembering, a postmortem, as this is in a way. Let's have a little moment of silence for arcade games. A kid. But in the end, what I'm talking about is the fact that things are changing, things are different. Next Machina may be the last of its kind. So remember that as I speak through it. Remember heartwarmingly the arcade games that you grew up with. Remember all this stuff, because if you don't do something about it, this actually might be the last of its kind. And we don't really know what that means for video games, but let's try to find out. Is this the clicker that I just drowned in water? Okay. All right. So, bit of a cup of the company, story of Next Machina. My name is Mikael Haveri. I'm the head of publishing at Housemarque. Housemarque is an independent studio, a stone's throw or two distance from here. Started in 95 from two different companies. And we kind of just want to make a great place to work. On the other hand side, the games we make are very much reminiscent of the games that we played. And usually, people tend to see our titles as rip-offs of other games from the golden era. But in the end, we like to think that we add a touch, the Housemarque touch. But that's been our mission statement for a long time, is really recreating classics in a way. And gameplay is very central to that ethos. And I think if you want to take one takeaway from what Housemarque does or what we aim to do, gameplay would be that answer. Let me just open this thing here carefully. Thanks for the water. So, let's get right to it. These are some of the games that we made in the past, give or take 10 years. Alienation, Resogun, Outland Detonation. A lot of these are Sony exclusive titles. So the last 10 years, it's been a lot about Sony, PlayStation 4 exclusives. Resogun was a launch title, smaller arcade games, but actually Resogun was the highest rated exclusive game on PS4 for the first about a year and a half until Bloodborne came out, and Bloodborne definitely deserved to overtake that, definitely. But this is about Next Machina, and what is Next Machina, how it became to be, and what were the kind of nuances. How did we want to create it? I'll try to answer that question here. So this happy, smiley fellow is actually an insane psychopath game developer that doesn't show it up too much when he smiles and giggles all the time. But he is somebody who we loved a lot. And he's influenced almost every single game Housemarque has ever made, purely for the reason that he invented twin-stick shooters, which is basically what we do. So. We had the opportunity to meet this guy at DICE Awards a couple years back. Resogun was nominated for the Best Action Game of the Year, and Eugene Jarvis was getting the Pioneer Award. So it made sense for us to get drunk and then have the courage to go talk to the guy. And he didn't really know who we were, but we said, Defender, we kind of took that and we did Resogun, and let's just have drinks and you'll figure out later. And he actually went home. Their office just got the PS4 because it was still fairly new. And he played Resogun. And the next day he called us and he's like, fuck yeah, we need to make a game, come on. And we started making a game with the guy. So that's kind of how this project started.
I am proud to call him my mentor, my friend, and be a part of this special evening. Let's welcome 2014's Pioneer Award recipient, Eugene Jarvis.
Well, a sparsely furnished office in a rundown section of Chicago, there's a young man with a mission to put you back in the driver's seat.
Players don't like to get stuck in the same reality, just like they don't like to get stuck on the same game.
Because you're still making arcade games.
Okay.
Coin-operated games.
Right.
It seems to me that the arcade business model is dead.
You know. Well, okay.
I mean, Mark, when's the last time you went into an arcade?
I have not been in an arcade in this century.
In this century.
Okay. All right. Okay.
I mean, what's going on?
So we still like to party like arcades aren't dead, but now we're students starting to realize that arcade are, they're indeed dead. So what do we do about this? Well, we made the last final culmination of arcades, really. That's how we started in our minds. We just came off of Resogun, and that was a surprisingly well-received and well-played, and people really, we saw like, hey, maybe there's a fire and a light that we can reignite to get people to play these very simple arcade games again. And we wanted to really see what we could do with this legend and you know, if that could be the magic formula. So we started prototyping a game called The Jarvis Project. We announced it quite early, and we came up with the idea of doing something in the vein of Robotron 2084 and also Smash TV. And we got this guy on board, so, I mean, can't go wrong. You know, we'll try our best and we'll see what happens. So we started with talking to some artists. I saw this guy, Jakub Prusalski, on online, internet, as you do most things. I really like this art. He had this kind of, World War I or kind of really off the beaten path kind of look with mechs on these, beautiful Soviet paintings with mechs. It looked cool. So I contact the guy. I'm like, hey, what are you doing? You want to do some concept art? So, he came up with some cool concept art for us. These are, I don't know if you've seen them, but they never publicly went out. But these were some of the ideas he came up with. We really just wondered, like, let's do robots. Let's do a world where robots are in charge and humans, like, they don't matter. Like, who cares about the humans? Humans are so ignorant with their mobile devices in this alternative future that they just kind of lost interest in everything, and they just wandered off in the nature, and robots took over, and nobody really noticed. So that's kind of our mentality that we started off with. This is a beautiful piece, by the way. I think this really encapsulates the beginning of what we try to create artistically. Humans just, they don't matter. That's kind of what we started off with. And then from there we said, okay, we still need a protagonist, we still need something that we can actually put in the game, not just a philosophical overlaying touch. So we came up with this guy with a helmet and a jacket and a gun, but the world around it still looked a bit too colorful. So we took a step back and we started defining more of what we wanted the game and the environment and everything to look like. So we found another artist. His name is actually just Mac. One of our guys, Tommaso, worked with him before, so he just said, let's talk with this guy. And he really got this darker tone going, inspired by, you know, Tetsuo from Akira and Blame and all these cool kind of Japanese darker tones that we got in there. And actually, you can see the robot on the bottom there is still in the game that we used. We created a vision guide. To kind of tie in all these things together and, you know, try to define it, just not just to ourselves, but to everybody else, like, what do we want the world to feel like? What is the essence of Nex Machina? A scary kind of a world, but still something a bit utopian. Anti-utopian, I guess. Cable punk was one of the terms that we coined. It's not quite cyberpunk or any other punks out there. Cable punk means it's that grittier and just a shit ton of cables, which also gave us a good visual aesthetic. Let's put a lot of cables in the game. Cables also became very central to how humans got their three needs, which are internet, electricity, and sludge. The sludge is, of course, food in a green format. We put humans in. If you've seen the movie Wall-E, these were the humans we aimed to do. We didn't want to go that across the board disgusting, but we ended up going with something that people could still relate to. So they're just kind of more like the Wall-E cartoony one we have ended up with. We created this world, very, very stereotypical world. So you start off in the forest where there's just a little bit of kind of robot takeover. Still, you can see the kind of natural world. You start going into an ice mountain, and then you go to a fire cavern. And all throughout the whole journey, you start seeing this darker tones pop up. But this kind of all tied it together for us. It was very easy to communicate with our team, and we got to use the most stereotypical video game settings, lava caves, etc. It was a lot of fun. So after we got that done, we needed a face. What's the face of the game going to be like? And you know, I asked this guy who created all this art, I said, let's do a logo. Let's not just do a text logo, which is very, you know, a lot of video games do just that. But we wanted a symbol, and I was, you know, symbol, you can spell it with a Y also, but this is the way we spell it. But we wanted a symbol, something that represented it, something that would communicate without text, the kind of menace, the hardcoreness of the game that we wanted to instill in. So black and red really felt like the central themes, but all the stuff that we had, it just didn't work. Until the same guy came up with some t-shirt designs. And you can see there's this one design that kind of stuck. And I was like, maybe there's something we can do with this. And that's kind of menacing. It looks like a yield sign. It's red. It is kind of, it's mean. It looks badass. So we started testing this with some fellow developers. And they came up with something like, okay, it's simple, crazy. Eugene said it looked like the Superman logo, so he didn't actually like it. But yeah, so we kind of took that and run with it. We edited it a little bit. So one of our most biggest concerns was you have to cut off the penis, that you can't have a penis on your logo. But yeah, so that had to go. And this is what we ended up with, and that's what we ran with. And in the end, it was something that I think, you know, it's simple to recognize. We wanted just people to be like, yeah, that's the game that I need to be kind of afraid of in a way. So from there, marketing art, again, this is the original sketch for the first marketing art. We debuted it at Gamescom 2016. We didn't even have the name of the game out yet, so the name of the game was actually a big thing still. But we came up with these cool things, and that's kind of what we put out. We tried to kind of hide the next name into it, but only like two journalists picked up on that, the hidden thing. You should always try to hide cool Easter eggs and everything, and don't expect everybody to find them, though. Yeah, Harry still doesn't like it. Our co-founder still hates the logo. But we had a lot of different variations during the all the phases that we could get the thing together. So now we have a project. Now we have a visual style. Everything's getting together. Now the people are making a game. So I came, you know, we had to do some marketing videos. I contacted a friend of mine. I said, listen, you guys come in, you guys do some marketing videos. We'll pay you. It's all good. Don't worry about it. They start kind of just making marketing videos. And then a couple of months back, they came back to us and said, listen, there's a movie here. And they got funding for the movie. So we sold away our rights, and now there's a movie. It's an hour and 40 minutes. It's going to be hopefully debuting at Sundance Festival. We don't know. It's out of our hands. But if you see the movie, you know, don't be too harsh on us. That's just us in the movie. It's fine. Maybe we can take a little look of what that looks like. Tonight, it's a big thing for us at Housemarque. We're announcing our next game project. Woo! And we'll be working together with Eugene to make that next project. So
why was I not informed of this? Oh, I like that when I die.
I'm here counting the cents to make this.
3,610,000 dollars.
What is that?
In Finland, a lot of nerds. Wow. A lot of nerds.
You need to be able to go from inserting the coin to seeing shit blow up within, I think, 2 seconds max.
So we still don't have a name for the game.
Any good idea?
He's the last Robo Fighter.
Adam Viper.
Yatvoy Robotnik.
Eradicator.
Flash Machine.
Laser Warrior.
The First Law.
Bruiser.
Bolt Bath.
What?
Bolt Bath.
Bolt.
Like a bloodbath, but with bolts.
Guys, we're working with a living fucking legend here.
I'm telling you, this is going to be the best game Housemarque has ever made.
So what happens now? Do we need to pay the money back?
This may be my last shot here, you know? Yeah. Burn every bridge you can, you know?
Eugene Jarvis.
Yeah. We had a lot of fun, and I think that it was very much a passion project. And once you start making a passion project, you lose a lot of the things that you should have when making a logical decisions and so on. But we secured the name. Next Machina, we announced it, trademarked it everywhere. But the name was a big part of it, and hence the movie is called Name of the Game. Application bullshit, etc. We actually got t-shirts now, so people could actually work with us, because usually Sony owns the IP and they have the rights to do merchandise, but you can actually go on fangamer.com and buy these sweet, sweet merchandise right now. Yeah, all right. Plug one. We actually did work with Sony pretty closely, and with NVIDIA later on, to just make things happen on a level that we personally couldn't do. This was, after all, our first self-published game, and it's going to be a lot of hard work, so partners always help out with that. So that being said, we got to announce this, and there's probably a little clip. I'm running out of time here, so I'll try to fast forward to that. Things started going pretty well. Fan response was crazy. We were at PSX last December, and just shit was blowing up. It was the indie game, and people were looking forward to it. And it felt good. It felt really good. Some more on that here.
We're actually part there of the indie booth guys now.
Yeah.
But honestly, in all of these expos, I always think that the indie booths are the coolest places to hang out. Seriously.
Yeah.
Like, I really like just playing the games there, just talking to the people, and it feels real, you know?
Yeah.
Rather than all of this, like, super huge thing. This thing to start, man.
So that was very awesome to see your passion project. Literally the culmination of everything the company stood for being received well, and it's just an awesome feeling. We announced the PC version. We did a lot of beta testing, which we've never really done before, and there's a lot of value in beta testing and building a community and all that stuff. So everything was going really, really well. We did marketing, everything we could on our own, and then got some other people to help us out. Just to get, you know, because crunch time comes and, you know, you can't handle everything on your own. And we released it just a couple months back, and it went well. It went really, really, really well. Prove me wrong if you can. I don't know, but I think that's still the best finish Metacritic. I could be wrong. Never mind. But it was very good for us. We're very happy with the product, the reception, and everything. Everything is so good until we saw the sales numbers come in, and we're like, fuck. It didn't sell shit. There's nothing to be said about the game. It's perfect. But arcade is dead. There's no way you can sell a game like this, even with that critical reception, and get the money back that you put in. And we kind of had an idea that this might be the case, but this was our chance to do and show off what we always wanted to do. So, I mean, it was a journey of a lifetime. I think in the end, if you watch the movie, maybe some of that will be communicated, and hopefully there's a lot of lessons to be learned here. We love what we do, and we will continue to do what we love to do. And all I'm saying is that arcade is dead. Probably try to do some other kind of games if you want to make money in this business. But this is enough for us for now. But still very, very cool things to come in the future. So be on the lookout. That's all for me for now. Thank you very much.